Good morning, and welcome to worship on this 15th Sunday after the day of Pentecost. And we also celebrate today as a nation Labor Day. And so our special word of welcome to all of you who are able to join us here today, and a special word of welcome for those who will be watching us later on our YouTube channel. We are delighted that you are able to join us in this worship service. Today is also a special day because as the first Sunday of the month, we will be gathering up front at the altar and celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion. Today, because of COVID restrictions, we will be proceeding to the altar railing one family at a time. And that is for everybody's safety, but we look forward to being able to celebrate this sacrament as we gather together at the table as our Lord invites us to come eat, drink, and be fed. A couple of announcements to highlight or call to your attention. First of all, council will be meeting on Monday, September 13th at 6:30 here at church downstairs in the basement. Women's Fellowship will also meet that same afternoon, Monday, September 13th at 1:30 here in the church basement. We invite all of you to join us for a short Bible study and a time of fellowship. We're looking forward to being able to gather together. And then finally, a couple of weeks from now, September 19th is Rally Sunday, where we kick off a new program year for faith formation. We are going to be having a joint worship service over at Faith Lutheran. At 8:30 to 12:30, the lunchbox food truck will be serving both breakfast and lunch outside in the church parking lot. At 9 o'clock, young families and kids for Sunday school age are invited to join us outside at Faith for the Olympics, the Sunday school Olympics. So we're looking forward to that. That should be a lot of fun. And then at 10:15, the Benson Family Singers will be with us and will be leading us in worship. So it should be a wonderful day. So please mark that on your calendars. And we look forward to being able to kick off a new program year. Today, we also want to extend our thanks to Mickey Christensen, who is able to share her ministry of music with us here today. And so thank you so much, Mickey. We really appreciate it. And today for our prayers, we want to say prayers for safe travel for those family members who might be away this weekend enjoying the beautiful weather. We also pray for those of you who have remained here close to home that you would have time to enjoy the blessings of a beautiful weekend. It's a great weekend to get out and enjoy the sunshine, a little bit cooler temperatures, which is kind of nice to see too. So we pray for God's gift of refreshment on this Labor Day weekend. And finally, our prayers are with the people who are recovering from Hurricane Ida. I heard as of yesterday, 700,000 people in Louisiana are still without power, including some of the church areas in Slidell where we used to go down and help with Hurricane Katrina updates. So they have their hands full, especially given the fact that they're still having 90-degree temperatures. Without power is really tough for them. But our prayers are also with my first church, as you remember, was in Metro New York Synod. And we've seen the pictures out of New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. And it's unbelievable how many states have been affected by one storm. And so our prayers are with first responders, with families who have lost a lot, and for the recovery efforts. We pray that God will give them strength and bring healing in the aftermath of that storm. Are there any other announcements or things I forgot? All right, let us begin our worship. I invite you to please stand as you are able, and we begin with a word of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Amen. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our Comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. And as a forgiven people of God, living in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us gather as a community to sing our opening hymn, All People That on Earth Do Dwell, hymn number 883. Let us pray together the prayer of the day. Gracious God, throughout the ages, you transform sickness into health and death into life. Open us to the power of your presence and make us a people ready to proclaim your promises to the whole world. Through Jesus Christ, our healer and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of the lessons.
First reading comes from Isaiah chapter 35, verses 4 through 7. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For water shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading comes from James chapter 2, verses 1 through 17. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ. For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Have a seat here, please," while to the one who is poor you say, "Stand there or sit at my feet," have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be the heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme that excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but you do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you say to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill," and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know that he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile, of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying in the bed, and the demon gone. Then Jesus returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up into heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. God's grace, peace, and mercy be with you. In the name of the Spirit of our risen and ascended Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As you know, when I was in seminary, I had the great privilege to do the only trip I've ever taken outside of the United States. After spending a month in studying in Zimbabwe, I broke away from our group from seminary and flew to Kenya, where a good college friend of mine was there working in the Peace Corps, teaching at a school for the deaf. at a Catholic mission compound way out in the bush, only a few miles from the border with Uganda. I will never forget the first day I arrived there. The Catholic sisters were so welcoming, as were the students. One day, my friend woke me up early and said, "How would you like to come with me and teach a class?" Well, all I knew of sign language was the finger alphabet, which was enough to make communication possible. And yet, when you have to do every single word spelled out individual letters, conversation takes a really, really long time. But my most vivid memory happened at lunch that day. And again, later on that afternoon when we were outside with the kids playing volleyball. The thing that shocked me the most was, at a school for the deaf, how incredibly loud everything was. And I say that because even though there was not the sound of the students talking, you could hear a whole nother litany of sound arising. At lunch, you could hear all the spoons scraping against the bowls. And I heard, even toward the end, some of the kids slurping up their soup. And while we were outside that afternoon playing volleyball, I could hear the sound that the palm makes as it slaps the volleyball. I heard the sound of the grunts of effort that the students expended as they put all their energy into hitting that ball over the net. I had no idea how loud the world is when you take away the sound of speech. The same was true that night when the students wanted to dance for me as a gesture of welcome and hospitality. Though they couldn't hear the sound of the music or the sound of the drums, they could feel the vibration on the floor. And once again, I was so shocked at how loud the sound was of their feet hitting the floor as they danced and moved. They never missed a beat. And I found myself trying to listen for the sound of that vibration, which of course didn't work because you can't hear vibration. You need to feel it. I have never forgotten this encounter because it was such a different world than anything I had gotten used to. And I share it with you because it raises the question that today's gospel reading asks of us. What would we hear if we took the time to stop talking and focused instead on hearing, on listening? Sometimes those who are deaf are truly the ones who hear. And other times we who are able to hear are oftentimes the ones who are deaf. What would we hear if we took time to stop talking and focused instead on listening? One answer to this question is it depends on where we are when we listen. If we are in familiar surroundings, you're probably going to expect something to hear. But that's not what today's gospel is all about. In fact, notice in these two miracle stories where Jesus is when he encounters both of these people. Both of these times, he's forced to listen. In the first part of the gospel, Jesus is off by himself, but he's in a strange new territory, a territory called Tyre. It is a Gentile territory. In the second story, or second healing part of the gospel, he is near there through Sidon in the region of the Decapolis. Tyre and Sidon were areas that the evil Queen Jezebel from the Hebrew scriptures, that was her territory, very pagan territory. And because it was Gentile or pagan territory, it was an area deemed to be unclean or scary. Places that good, faithful Jews never wanted to associate with or be seen in. The kind of places that they would never take a vacation in. And so don't you just wonder what Jesus was thinking when he went there? But he went there, according to Scripture, because he wanted some time away. He wanted some time alone to get away to think and to pray, to unwind and relax. He probably thought going to a strange area, he could remain incognito. That is, no one in such a foreign territory would know him, and therefore he could get the alone time that he needed. Yet, as Scripture tells us, even there, in that strange, faraway place, he could not help but gain notice. That phrase always makes me chuckle, because whenever you're in a new territory, the fact of the matter is you're probably going to stick out. In fact, one of the villages I visited when I was in Kenya, I was the only white person for miles. There was no way, even if I tried, that I could blend in or escape being noticed because I stuck out like a sore thumb. The same was true for Jesus. And this is when Jesus, even Jesus, began to hear something that was truly new. He heard not the voices of the Jewish faithful, something that he had listened to his entire life. But now he heard for the first time a voice of the faithful who was not Jewish, but was Gentile. And what is more, it was a female voice, which was shocking because women in that day and age were not permitted to speak in public to men who were not their husbands. And after Jesus spoke to her, probably expecting her to back away because of the authority that males had in that society, he probably heard for the very first time a female voice that openly challenged him and in fact turned his own argument right back against him. But notice, in spite of how strange that argument is, notice how Jesus reacts. He could have gotten angry. He could have gotten defensive or blew her off. He even could have gotten her in very big trouble for bothering him. But he does none of that. For truly he heard her faith. He listened to what she had to say. And then he healed her daughter. I love this part of the story. Think of how hard it must have been for Jesus to stand there and have this woman challenge him. It would have been far easier for him to have remained in his home territory, where everything was the same and familiar, and where he didn't have the possibility of encountering another who would change his mind. The question is, are we that brave? Are we willing to follow Jesus into unfamiliar territory? Or will we cling stubbornly to only what we know? Are we open to listening to the voices of the unknown and the challenging? Are we willing to risk having to change our minds because of who we have encountered and what we will have to hear? Are we willing to admit that faithful people might be just dwelling in places that are unlike anything that we have ever experienced before? And the second part of the story in the gospel asks that same thing of us. Jesus is once again in the unfamiliar territory. And this time, rather than be confronted by a conversation of an individual, he is confronted by an entire group of people who had brought a deaf man to him. This group was so persistent because rather than just dropping their friend at the feet of Jesus and disappearing, their duty done, this group stayed, and they begged Jesus to heal him. The faith that they show is incredible. Who have we been that persistent in seeking help for? Who have we gone out of our way to bring to Jesus? Or are we afraid to speak up, afraid of being embarrassed or turned down, made fun of or rejected? Once again, in these strangers, Jesus recognizes their great faith, and he heals him. But the interesting thing here is not only does he heal his deafness, but notice that he also touches his tongue, because the ability to speak well is dependent upon the ability to hear. And so it is with us. What we have the power to speak depends on what we hear. Perhaps our prayer should be the same as Jesus. Epitha, be opened. Be open to follow Jesus into unknown and unfamiliar territory. Be opened to the people we will encounter. Be opened to their great faith. Be open to the ways in which their presence will challenge us. And be open to even changing our minds and our hearts when that is called for. For it is in the midst of this encounter, this situational deafness that we have can truly be opened to hear the sound of the gift of God's healing. Sometimes that unfamiliar territory will encourage us to cross boundaries of race or gender, as we saw in today's gospel story. Other times, the unfamiliar territory will encourage us to cross boundaries of someone who is just like us, but who happens to hold the opposite opinion on some issue. And boy, have we learned the truth of that one these last couple of years, haven't we? Sometimes it's tempting to want to walk away because we think we have the right opinion. And so we keep talking and shouting, but we stop listening. And so the prayer that Jesus speaks, Ephatha, be opened. May that be our prayer. May we be opened to hear. May we be opened to listen. May we be open to the encounter, even when it's uncomfortable. May we be opened to be changed. For it is truly then that we will encounter and be able to then speak the powerful word of healing. During the next few months, where will you be traveling? Where will Jesus lead you in your journey? Whether we go far away or we stay right here, may we be excited for the continuation of our journey of faith. May we be humbled for what and who we will encounter along the way. And may we be opened to the healing that God will bring as we encounter the truth, as we listen to one another and see the great faith that others have and are healed and blessed by that great gift. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us sing together the hymn of the day, Healer of Our Every Ill, hymn number 612. Thank you. invite you to please stand, and together let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, made children and heirs of God's promise, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Holy One, you bring your people together in worship. Enliven the gift of your church. Guide all who seek to share your love through word and through deed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, you are our creator. Bless all who advocate for healthy environments. Inspire all people to show care and stewardship for this beautiful world that you have made. We also, Lord, pray for your healing for those areas touched by flooding, by hurricanes, by incredible drought. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, you show no partiality. Increase justice in all nations. Encourage leaders and governments to work with each other for the good of the common world. Unite us as we seek the health, safety, and dignity of all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Savior, you accompany those who are most in need. Shelter all who are fleeing violence or persecution. Protect any who are in danger this day, and sustain them through uncertain and unstable times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, you support the work of all your disciples. Continue to nurture the leadership and ministries of this congregation. We also pray for those in our midst who are most in need of your healing. Today we pray for your healing for Marion and for Larry. We also pray for Jordan. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts that are known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the night to which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, the table is ready, and all are welcome. You may be seated. And I invite the communion assistants to please come forward. And again, for communion, it will be here at the altar, and we will have one family come forward at a time. I invite you to please stand. And let us receive the blessings of Almighty God. People of God, you are the body of Christ, bringing new life to a suffering world. May the Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen. Now that we have been fed and nourished and sent out with blessing, let us sing our sending hymn together, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, hymn number 742. Again, we want to say thank you for joining us in worship as we gather as a community of faith, the body of Christ, the church. Next Sunday, we will return to full liturgy, something that we have not had in a very long time, so we're looking forward to that. And also next Sunday at Faith, they are having a baptism, so we pray for Chase Michael Christensen and his family as he receives the sacrament of holy baptism. And now that we have been transformed by God's life-giving word, we have experienced the gift of healing, and we have been fed and nourished here at our Lord's table. Let us go in peace, for the living word dwells in you. Thanks be to God. Blessings on your week.